Getting confused, lost, or what feels like fatigue of your brain could be associated with brain fog. This mental fatigue inside of a learning environment, like a school, can lead to disruptive people. People staring out windows, or the person not learning anything once a personal fatigue line has been hit, which John Sweller termed cognitive overload. Cognitive overload is a term from cognitive load theory, which looks to explain how cognitive load, mental effort, can interact with abilities to remember or learn information. The theory assumes knowledge can be divided into biological primary and secondary knowledge. This idea came from Geary's work from 2007 and 2008, which assumes we naturally learn some information, which is biological primary knowledge, but other information isn't so natural and requires a little effort, which is biological secondary knowledge. Learning to listen and speak are examples of biological primary skills, whereas biological secondary knowledge is more culturally important, like reading and writing. We might not be naturally motivated to learn to read and write without our culture and society, which requires considerable conscious effort over a long period of time. This idea also suggests that organizing information is natural. We organize the words we hear by ourselves to learn to speak. It is when the information is too complex that we may need assistance. An example used in the paper is a university student, if they cannot organize information, it is more likely that they suffer from the complexity of the information they are dealing with, rather than an ignorance of how to organize information. Going on to say that a biological primary skill like organizing information might not be teachable, but the secondary skill of using the information could be. What our brain does during learning is still not entirely clear, but we have lots of ideas. In cognitive load theory, there are five principles that are assumed to be true. We store information through the information store principle. We get information from others by the borrowing and reorganizing principle. We create novel ideas to us through the randomness as genesis principle. Our ability to create the novel ideas is limited by the narrow limits of change principle. And we use the stored information to make decisions, which is through the environmental organizing and linking principle. Store, borrow, create, limit, use. Chess is seen as a game of problem solving, but what researchers have found is that it's actually more reliant on memory. Grandmasters have better memory, associated with the areas of the rules in chess to solve the position they are in. But a competent person isn't someone that has acquired lots of information and remembered it. It needs to be domain specific and can be applied in the context at hand, i.e. the chess positions. So they need a deep degree of understanding, which I explored in that review I mentioned earlier. We learn things from others far more than creating our own novel ideas, but it isn't a copy and paste of the information to our memory. As we change the information, leave bits out, or add connections from our own perspective and prior knowledge. When problem solving, we will use the store, long-term memory, and the chunks of information or schema to help us recognize the problem, making connections. The chess pieces, rules, and positions we know all being used to help us solve a position. Those experts having larger chunks makes it easier for them to solve positions as they have more information to use. If we are not familiar, we can guess or use read-around knowledge, a term from meta-ignorance literature, to try and come up with a solution. But that can lead to misunderstanding the problems, resulting in misconceptions, or finding an incorrect solution even though you followed the rational path you had in your head. This could be a rational error from the meta-ignorance literature, also known as the Einschlung effect, I think I've said that right, making the problem more complicated than it actually is. During all of this problem solving, it is suggested we have a limit in capacity and duration. The paper references the work of Miller and Peterson on the working memory model, giving 7 items of novel information and about 20 second limit. But the 7 item isn't very clear as we don't know what 1 item actually is. I will do a video on that in the future, but if I haven't done one already, depending on when you're watching this video, meaning the 20 seconds only works for novel information you forget, which relates to the forgetting curve, which isn't as smooth as you may think. Again, look out for a future video on that. But inside this working memory, we are processing, which in Sweller's words is combining, contrasting, or dealing in some manner with multiple elements. An element being information, which could be singular or chunks. Essentially, anything being used in thinking. The working memory uses signals from our environment to decide what elements from long-term memory are relevant to the current processing. picking from a library of information that we think could be useful for the current task of understanding. All of the processing that happens in our brain supposedly creates a cognitive load, which comes from the environment, the task we are trying to do, and the past information we are using, which is determined by element interactivity. A reminder, elements being information we are using during thinking. Intrinsic load is fixed once you have started a task and refers to complexity of the information you are taking in. If the complexity of the information is high, so maybe you are unfamiliar with the thing, the element interactivity will be high, essentially meaning you get overloaded and confused. Alternatively, the information isn't that complex, the intrinsic load is low, and so you can solve the problem. Thinking back to the student organizing information example, it is easier to organize simple things than complex things. If the information we are consuming is perceived as simple, then Sweller would suggest you have enough understanding of the information. But if it is complex, you don't have enough understanding. The review I mentioned earlier has a different perspective of understanding, but for this video, I think we'll just stick with this. So the understanding of information is what we are looking for, because that means we have learned from the information and have it stored in our memory for use. This is where various cognitive load effects can be seen inside of the learning journey that we can use to adjust how we teach or how we learn. The variability effect suggests we want to increase variability of a task if intrinsic load is low. So trying to find something that isn't too easy. The isolated elements effect suggests breaking things down can make things simpler, reducing intrinsic load instead of doing it all at once, do it in parts. But the rest of these effects relate to extraneous load, which is from the environment. These are the things that we could, should look to control in some way to prevent the brain fog, fatigue, confusion, those sorts of things from happening. The goal-free effect suggests removing a goal potentially reduces extraneous load, so even though goals can help, they can also get in the way. The worked example effect suggests looking at a demonstration reduces extraneous load in solving the problem. So it helps with initial understanding, but if you're anything like me, you might be thinking, I need to do it myself to understand it. And we'll get to that. The split attention effect suggests combining or grouping things helps us focus, which decreases extraneous load. So not doing lots of different things at once. The modality effect suggests using audio and visuals helps with understanding. So try and read and listen, or look at images or presentations and listen, or watch videos or read the words while listening to them. The redundancy effect suggests reducing redundant information, which I think is fairly obvious, but what you see as redundant might be beneficial to others or for you later on. So keep that in mind when deciding what is redundant or not. The element interactivity effect is the general idea of making sure you don't have too much load, avoiding overload. So don't do lots of different tasks at the same time and give yourself time to recover. The expertise reversal effect suggests information that is relevant to novices may be redundant for experts. So like the redundancy effect, pay attention to the information you need, not things that are too complex or too simple. The problem completion effect is an extension to the worked example effect mentioned earlier. Instead of using a worked example, using a partially completed problem to alter the load for the learning, looking for that desirable difficulty. The guidance fading effect is another extension of these effects, where experts should be given problems with guidance to solutions rather than directions on how to get there. All of these related ideas can be manipulated in different ways, in a philosophy of practice, as a learner or an educator. The imagination effect suggests that those with expertise in a topic can imagine procedures or concepts which can help with understanding. So in the chess example, the grandmaster players may imagine a few board moves in advance to help them solve the problem using their memory store. The transient information effect suggests offloading information to something like technology can increase extraneous load because you can't remember information from your biological memory, making it harder to create connections, to grasp concepts for deeper understanding. There is an element of truth to this, but the application of this in practice needs to consider the literature on note-taking and the extended cognition. With all the various effects that Sweller suggests that impact cognitive load, he emphasizes they should not be considered in isolation. Something I think lots of people do. That is because of X effect or Y effect, not considering the underlying theory of cognitive load. application of this theory could be seen in philosophy of practice and learning, which will look different for each individual in each environment as constraints emerge. The ideas that we receive, borrow, process, create, and use information is not new or novel, but the concept of cognitive load and manipulating it to help learning environments is what the theory really contributes to educational science. This theory is at the core of many information processing theories, concepts and frameworks around learning, including multimedia education, which Derek's thesis goes through, and countless others. But it does leave me with questions about how to measure the load. Can we measure the load? How does our perception impact the load? And most importantly, what does the processing part really include? What do you think?